It's time for MacBreak Weekly. Andy, Alex, and Rene are here. The hangover from WWDC is worn off. Let's talk about what really happened, what really is coming in iOS 8 and macOS 10, 10.10. We'll analyze all the details next on MacBreak Weekly.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for MacBreak Weekly is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com.
This is MacBreak Weekly, episode 406, recorded June 10th, 2014. Goal! MacBreak Weekly is brought to you by Lynda.com. Learn what you want, when you want, with access to over 2,400 high-quality online courses, all for one low monthly price. To try it free for 7 days, visit lynda.com/MacBreak. That's lynda.com/MacBreak. And by audible.com. To download a free audiobook of your choice, visit audible.com/MacBreak. And by Squarespace, the all-in-one platform that makes it fast and easy to create your own professional website or online portfolio. For a free 2-week trial and 10% off, visit squarespace.com and use the offer code MacBreak. It's time for MacBreak Weekly, the show where we cover Mac and Apple news weekly. And here we are again. Seems like we just did this last week. Alex, Lindsay in studio once again from the Pixel Core, pixelcore.com.
I'm here.
Good to see you.
Good to be here.
You got your summer haircut?
I did. I get my quarterly haircut. You know, it gets pretty shaggy, and then I put a lot of product in it. Then I'm like, okay, can't take it. Candace.
Oh, four baby. Times a year.
Usually. It's...
Candace, you go to Candace? So
yeah.
Do I.
Yeah.
We share barbers. Yeah. I see Candace more than you do, though.
You do a lot more than I do. I think she has to look at me, like, for a second and make sure she still recognizes me. Yeah, exactly.
Mr. Hughes? Also here from imore.com, it is Rene Ritchie, back in Montreal.
I missed the studio, Leo. I can't lie. You were so much more three-dimensional when I was there in person.
It was fun having you guys here. And that great picture, Andy Ihnatko, you took of all of us. Why was I making a face? I don't understand. Andy Ihnatko from the Chicago Sun-Times is here.
I don't know. I think it's because we only had a few, like 5 seconds to get it done because
we did it quick.
Sort of people, and we had to do it quick, and we didn't do the countdown 3, 2, 1, look presentable. And so
I feel like I kind of look like one of those teenagers who doesn't like having his picture taken and so is mugging for the camera. Here, I have the shot.
I think it's sticking your tongue out like Miley Cyrus. That's what she said.
Leo, smile. Look at the camera. Leo, stop it.
Yeah.
Leo.
I'm trying to load this from the drop box that you placed it on. You didn't take it down, did you?
No, I did not. As a matter of fact, I can, with the power of my wall of sound set up here.
You could like actually this. Do that. Put it up there instead of Craig Federighi. That's a good shot.
It's a gorgeous picture.
Love having that. I should make that my banner for something. There it is. I got it on my screen now. Just took a while to get there.
But I was worried that it might freak people out because here we are in this screen and then there we are on that screen over there.
The odd thing.
I would like to blow people's minds with our analysis, not with our video trickery.
Video trickery, eh? That's what you call it? I don't know why I'm doing that.
There's two frames, one of which you have your eyes semi-closed.
Yeah, no, this is the better of the two, I'm sure. You look good. You look like
I look like I'm in the middle of saying something, which is not the best thing, but okay.
Well, that's good. I don't know. I look like I'm sitting on something strange. Alex looks like he's planning his next revolution.
Andy looks a bit like
that's
Wolverine.
What I'm always doing.
And Rene just looks like a nice guy, as always. That's a great picture. Anyway, thank you for
OMD
sharing
that. EM1s.
And we were so young and happy back then.
Were the days.
People seemed to laugh.
A lot of gray hair. Then.
Yeah, well.
All the way across. We didn't start
look at that.
Way.
We are gray. We are gray beards, aren't we? Holy cow.
We're like the Craig Federighi Club.
So here we have, we like to do this 1 week later, after it's all sunk in. The big WWDC is over. Did any of you go? Because I didn't realize this, but we had Film Girl on Sunday on Twit, Christina Warren, and she won some sort of lottery that she got to stay through the developer conference and even got to abrogate the NDA so she could see stuff and talk about it, which is, The first time Apple's ever done
actually
that.
they changed the terms of the NDA for the betas and stuff like that, where you're not allowed to post screenshots, you're certainly not allowed to post code, but you can now talk about it in the abstract at least. So you can talk about the features you've seen, you can talk about how you intend to, how excited you are, of course. But yeah, that's an interesting twist, isn't it, compared to even the impossibility of previous years of having 2,000 people under NDA and no secrets getting out. Now either Apple is either becoming more open, or they are simply acknowledging that it's very, very tough to tell people that you are not allowed to even refer to stuff that is being talked about at WWDC.
Especially
now that they're releasing all the videos to anybody with a developer account, whether you pay for it or not, can now get access to every single one of those videos. So
actually, I don't think they're even logged in. I think anybody can go there now. I've gone many times. There's never been a paywall.
I'm not sure. I've been like binge watching these videos. It's like I haven't seen more than two episodes of House of Cards or Game of Thrones, but I've binge watched the entire WWDC set. I do remember at one point coming back the next day and trying to refresh the page and having to log back in again. I don't know whether that was related to the videos or because of the developer ID.
But you don't need a developer account. Anybody could watch this.
Yeah, I think this is a really good example for other people doing conferences. You know, that Apple, it's not about what people are saying. That's important and what we all want.
Yeah.
But that's not what brings people to conferences. What's bringing people to conferences is the engineers you get to talk to and the people that you get to meet and everything else. And that's why it sells out in like 45 seconds when they announce it.
To be fair, Google's done it for years.
Yep.
Microsoft did it at Build this year. Apple's the last to the party.
No, I'm saying this is just another example of the ones that really work. You know, for those, you know, I think that a lot of that's what we do is we do live streaming and we're constantly talking to clients about the fact that
open it up. Don't put it behind a paywall. Don't put it behind a wall of any kind.
Yep.
It's interesting this year too, because they're going to be doing an open beta for Yosemite, and that's not going to be real. I mean, there will be an NDA, but that's not going to be enforceable. And more than that, they had the lottery system for WWDC, so people could get tickets. But they also had some journalists who were given not just journalist tickets, but passes for the entire event. And the NDA, as far as I understand it, is just no screenshots, no videos, and no reviews. And the reason for that is because things are going to change over the beta. And if you start doing reviews or screenshots and things change, it creates false expectations with customers, and they think they're not getting what they should be getting. So that part, you know, is totally understandable. But it really is, you know, it's a Craig Federighi geekier, you know, Phil Schiller more happy and open sort of a thing. And I think it's terrific.
It's pretty awesome.
Yeah.
It does feel like a new era, finally, under Tim Cook. There were so many changes, I think. It was done so differently, and it was so, you know, the only thing was maybe like the old era, as they still were taking jabs at Google, maybe even more brutally than in the past. But it does feel a little bit more open, and I commend that. I think that's the right direction.
But so, no leaks. Yeah. I mean, at the same time, it's more open, but they were very good at keeping things like Swift a total secret.
Isn't that interesting? We did not know we had not heard one thing about Swift as a good example, about Swift until day of.
Which I thought was interesting, because it's just that we felt like everything's gotten really porous.
You know what? Here, it's very easy. You can keep people who work at Apple quiet.
Right.
That's not a problem.
It's
the
totally
Chinese
internal.
Suppliers.
Yep.
It's the manufacturers. Those guys, you can't keep them quiet. So we know everything there is to know about hardware because it's being made elsewhere. But software, you can keep a lid on it because those guys know their job is on the line. And they work for Apple, and perhaps they don't even have to be told your job's on the line. They care. They want to keep it a secret. They understand the value of that.
Right.
So did anybody, so you guys have been perusing the videos. I'm sure that Alex and I have not.
No. Yeah.
So I will open it up to you, Renee and Andy. Anything, tell us any sessions you, first of all, some sessions are blacked out until the day of. What did we learn by either going to WWDC or watching the sessions online?
Just that everything that was said in the keynote was just backed up by real content. Every video I looked at, I started off with even the most boring one, which is here's what the new camera APIs are. And you watch through it, and it's not just that, okay, I suppose we will begrudgingly allow you to set exposure. It's no, we will let you have like low level fine grained access. So if you want to do full on computational photography, we will let you. There's even a bracketing API so that if you want to take a sequence of photos with adjustments as you go through, there is micro adjustments to focus with some interesting. One of the things that keeps going through all these videos is that Apple is trying to get away from being specific about, and they're trying to teach developers don't count on anything about any device that we may or may not ship. For instance, in the camera video, they say, we won't let you specify a focus point because let's just say that the distance between the furthest and closest focusing point and the thickness of a device might not be the same from device to device. but even this thing will allow you to, they even have access to low level video. So if you want to do like live video transmogrifications, I'm not being as big of a half the expert that half of 1% the expert that Alex is. I don't know how big you can take advantage of this API, but I was surprised that if you want to have access to the video, you don't have to simply have it capture video and then do something to it later on. You can actually do live processing on it.
Wow.
And then when you look at how they've implemented extensions and see that, no, it's not just simply like in Android, there are ways to drop things into other apps. They're to paint on top of other apps. There are ways to make notifications actionable, but they're very, very useful, but not really ambitious. It becomes really, really clear that what Apple has done is told developers that you can develop an entire separate user interface for your app that only expresses itself inside the notification manager. And the limit, and when you project your features into the camera app or any other app that will accept extensions, it's not these simple, here's a function that you can lend out. You can actually project your app and a user interface from your app into that. So I can't wait to see how developers really take advantage of it. Because again, I intended to just skim over this and maybe download the PDFs to get a sense of it. But it really is just like when you start getting into Game of Thrones, you say, I will only watch the one where Peter Dinklage is on trial for whatever, because I didn't catch it. I didn't know what it was. And then it's 9 hours later, like, oh, damn it. Is it 11 p.m. already? Ah, damn it. I missed my sister's wedding. Because that it really is like the more you dive into this, the more you realize that this is full on the greatest updates that Apple has ever done to macOS and iOS.
Well, this is part of the sea change, too, opening up these APIs and letting people in. I mean, this is one of the things you never could do on the iPhone. It was Apple's way. You know, Apple did it.
We have to remember it started with no apps at all. I mean, you know, it was Apple's, right. You know, when I found my original... My 3G, or you know,
I have mine over in the other room. I'd have to find a 30-pin cable to charge it, though.
I can't get anything to launch right now, so I'm trying to figure it out. But I was going to give it to my son, and I started playing with it. I was like, wow, you know, that was like the.
It was pretty primitive
when you got it. But when you got it, you were just like, oh my gosh!
And yet,
you know?
We were thrilled. I waited 6 hours in line for that thing.
Oh yeah, yeah, and it was the best phone we ever had. And now it's
was
pretty,
so much better than anything we'd
it's
ever done.
Pretty ugly now. Go ahead.
Sorry, I was going to say, like, one of the interesting things for me is that about the new openness is they had people like Mike Stern, the Apple user experience evangelist, or one of the user experience evangelists. He did a whole talk just on design language and how they implemented it on OS X Yosemite and what they look for in great apps. Ken Kishinda, who was one of the original WebKit engineers and made the keyboard, he just did a talk about lessons that he learned trying to manage projects at Apple, which is not your typical WWDC talk, but is a fantastic talk. And to Andy's point, Apple's been working on interop communication for years. It's not like, you know, suddenly there's a switch in administration. They're like, okay, you guys can go do this. It's just that it took them a long time. Like it took them 3 years to get copy-paste. They had to figure out a system where, you know, malware couldn't travel between apps. And the reason that the different views are in different containers is for security, because it's a security-first operating system. But also, let's say you have Facebook, which is not the sveltest of applications, and that's running, and suddenly you have a Facebook notification or widget, and you decide to jettison the Facebook app because it's hogging memory, what happens to that, that widget, or what happens to that notification?
Right.
Well, if it's in its own container and its own daemon, nothing happens to it. You're totally free to do it. So by making it right, even though it took a long time, it opens up so much more functionality and gives such a better user experience that I would have liked it sooner, but I'm glad they did it the way they did it.
I did glance a little at the extensions. Go ahead.
Apple has previously on the iPhone actually had an about face on philosophy. Everyone I've spoken to about the allowment of third party apps says that this was a change of tactic, that they really did think that web apps were going to be the way to go, and then they changed their mind on it. Who knows for sure? But everyone I've been speaking to since then has said that that actually was a turn of opinion. But here I hedged my bets last week because I didn't know whether this new openness was a change of philosophy, or as Rene said, it took them a long time to figure out how to do this in a way that they felt was going to be safe for the platform. And over the past week, everyone I've spoken to has said exactly that it really has been. It took 4 years to figure out how to make apps work together in such a way that it's not going to cause malware, it's not going to cause destability, and it's going to be a net positive as opposed to a net set of disappointments for everybody.
And it is a bit of a mix because, like, to Andy's point, engineers could have built all this stuff and someone high up could just say no. And right. then after a while, the change in the person high up will say yes. But they've been working on it for a long time.
It's hard to do that and maintain security. And after, you know, one of the things they changed a lot in iOS 7 and the iPhone 5S was the security model. Significant changes.
Yeah.
And it may be that they wanted to wait till those were implemented. Well, and then you can start talking about opening an API because now you know what the safety parameters are. You also have hardware support for encryption and things. And I was I read the extensions API and I was very impressed. It seems a very clean, elegant implementation that both protects the user and gives developers a chance to kind of start hooking into other apps. I think it's good.
Well, number one is I think that part of this is also the maturity of the operating system because when you open up that API, that means that you're now locked in to what you. This is an agreement. It's not just that you're giving people access to your operating system; it's that you're making an agreement that you're only going to change it at a certain pace after that. And so I think by opening these up, we're now saying, okay, we've gotten to most of added what we want. We're just going to keep on changing it, but it's not going to change at the pace that it changed at before. I think the other thing though is I think with the privacy, I think that what Apple's doing is playing a game that a lot of their competitors like Google may not want to play because, I mean, Google's obviously going to work on they're encrypting email, they're working on privacy, but there's this back end issue of wanting to, you know, run ads and wanting to get information. And Apple is, I think we're going to continually see Apple doing things that break those things, you know, and because that's not because they're trying to hurt Google, but because they are differentiating themselves from many of the other competitors who run on an ad based model.
We spent a lot of time on Sunday at Twit talking about this and saying both Apple and Microsoft have an opportunity here to say, hey, we're the anti-Google.
Yeah, you're going to pay us up front. It's going to cost more. And what you're going to get from that is privacy. People aren't going to know when you're walking by unless you decide you want them to know. They're not going to. I mean, I can see Apple, you know, doing this kind of thing that they're talking about where you have a different credit card number every single time you make a purchase.
Idea.
You know, those are the kind of things that those are the kind of things that they can implement in a way that's difficult.
Well, and they have a cryptographic base now in there, their hardware. Chad brought me my original iPhone.
Look at that.
This is the thickest, heaviest, smallest iPhone we've ever made. This thing, it's noticeably thicker and heavier. And
they're not going to sell any of those.
Yeah, exactly.
it's so small that look how big the headphone jack looks. On this thing, it looks monstrous.
Well, no, because remember they had to drill it out because you couldn't put in a standard headphone connector
that's
in there.
Right, it's so deep. So, yeah,
remember those little adapters that we had, so they could
3GS. Yeah. I think is the.
It's still a good looking phone.
Still a good looking item. If that were in a claw machine outside the supermarket, I'd definitely put in two quarters to risk getting
is
that.
Is this the original one or is this the original one? I can't tell.
No, you're right. It's the original one.
The metal wax
band at the bottom, right, with the antenna cutout.
Yeah. Wow, it's kind of fun to see that.
I charged mine up. I found it. I charged mine up, and then it wouldn't start.
I bet this will start.
I charged mine up about a year ago. Because I was doing one of my like huge camera shootouts. I thought, oh well, let's compare this to. Let me tell you that it's freaking me out that when I look into this camera, I have like the live shot over there, and I see you all just like back there smiling and patiently waiting. And for a half a second, I think that maybe the video has frozen. I have to tell my brain not to worry about that anymore. I charged it up, and I couldn't believe how slow this thing was. I couldn't believe how crappy the screen was. It's like it's the best way to understand. Exactly how good a job Apple has done developing the iPhone is to spend 10 minutes with the iPhone 1 and see, no, this used to be the greatest phone in the world, the kind that people would line up for 6 hours to go get.
6 hours of my life. But I met some nice people in that line.
Yeah. Apple buyers are always fun to hang out with.
It wasn't shopping, it was an experience.
Cable. I'm ready. I'm charging it up right now. You can see it's dead, but I bet it'll come back.
Yeah.
I mean, why shouldn't it? It's all solid state and everything.
Mine came back. It just wouldn't. Every time I tried to start opening an app, it didn't work.
Well, I'll let you know. Well, before the show's over, we'll boot the iPhone, the original iPhone, and see what happens. It'll be a little slice of my life from 2007.
Exactly.
See all your jailbreak apps.
One of the things a lot of attention has been paid to is the Xcode 6. You know, and when you develop to Xcode, you can have target, devices, iPhone 5S. You can have an iPad. And now you have independent screen or variable screen resolution devices. And a couple of people have said that there were a number of mentions about this in the sessions as well at WWDC. Either one of you have anything to say about that? Are we going to? Is that merely Apple saying we're going to be more flexible, or is that paving the way for new screen sizes?
This is Apple's trying to emphasize to developers: do not count on your app being projected into a screen of any specific size. Yeah. I thought it's not, and they're doing it without having like 800 bogus screen sizes in there. They get it by saying, well, here's interface builder, here's a square to populate. So they're really trying to make people think of your app filling into an iPhone screen, into an iPad screen, a small iPad screen, into the dashboard of a car. Think about it as something that could fill an Apple TV screen and any other device that may come and go. This is not a new thing. Apple's been talking about screen size independence and, you know, an autofill, autoflow sort of operations for years now. This is the first time they've really sort of kicked people in the head and said that we don't want to create an interface builder environment that makes you think in terms of filling this iPhone-sized device. We want you to think of a blank screen of any size that you're going to have to populate with your interface. And now that you're projecting parts of your interface into other apps, that's also important, because even if Apple doesn't do a wristwatch with a color touch LCD screen, you're still going to have to think about how can you make your photo app or your scheduling app useful in a square size of real estate.
By the way, we do have the question engine up. twit.to/mbw406.
Exactly.
twit.to/
No dash this time.
We don't need to anymore, because we control our own shortener. twit.to/mbw406. It says 401 on there.
I screwed it up.
It has the wrong date. But that's me. That's ours.
And Andy's on a plane to come here, actually.
We use the question engine. Yeah, we use the question engine to give you a chance to ask questions and vote up or down the questions that you want to have answered, and we'll talk about those in just a little bit as well. What else did
before you move on, Leo? Yeah. The other thing that's interesting about the scaling stuff, and they showed that off in the State of the Union, so if you want to see a high-level version of that, just go to the State of the Union video, is that it provides like constraint-based layout, exactly what Andy said, and you can imagine that's for different screen sizes. But they started off with, you know, this is a 3.5-inch iPhone, 4-inch iPhone, this is an iPad, this is horizontal. But very quickly they got into, you know, compact, rectangle, small.
Right.
And you can imagine that for different screen sizes, but also when you start having, you know, maybe multiple panes in the same window, you have, and they explained this nicely, which they haven't really, for customers, they haven't really explained this before. It's known inside that the iPhone is one column shown at a time, where the iPad is two columns shown at a time.
Oh.
But that's not dependent on the device. You know, you can eventually have maybe two different apps side by side, or one small app and one big app side by side. It just liberates them to do a lot of more stuff with iOS than the pixel for pixel interface did.
I'm excited. How about fingerprint ID, touch ID? Did they, how's the API there? Does it look like it's complete enough?
That is really good. So the problem with touch ID previously is that, for example, if you just use a touch ID, all it does is release a yes, no token. And there's concerns that an app could spoof that. That's not very secure. And, you know, there were some circumstances with PayPal on Samsung. You know, immediately that gets compromised. And yeah, that was a CSI spoof, but whatever. With this, it goes into Keychain. So the token is actually being given to Keychain. It's not being given to developers. And then Keychain, which is an existing system on iOS and OS 10 since last year, verifies the user. And
again, they wanted to get the foundation in there,
yes,
which is Keychain, so they could do this in a responsible and effective way.
Yeah, security first.
Security first. You got to admire that, I really think. You got to admire what they're doing. This is, you know, this responds to the analyst who said Apple has 60 days and why are they taking so long? Is Apple has been moving fairly methodically and carefully. That's why they didn't even mention the iWatch. They're laying, it seems to me, you're right, with the variable screen resolutions, laying the foundation for some interesting stuff.
And you could see that, I mean, I don't think they would have shown it anyway, but it didn't ever appear, no matter what the analyst said, no matter what people were saying before last year, the Apple crew is just kind of like, well, you know, we've got some big stuff
planned. We'll be back to you.
You know,
we've got some interesting stuff.
Working on 4,000 APIs. We'll That's what they're thinking in the back of their head. You know, like, 4,000 APIs. Yeah, we got 4,000 APIs.
4,000. And those are just iOS 8 APIs.
Yes. Yes, exactly.
And that was the theme, though. It was security first, privacy first, people first. When you look at their approach to something like handoff or test flight or family sharing, it's not based on devices anymore. It's based on your Apple ID on people. And that's a completely different thing. I mean, Windows is doing interface first. You have the same interface everywhere.
Right.
Google's always been cloud truth store first, so you log into the cloud everywhere. Apple's like, no, you're people. You have, as long as we can identify you, as long as we know you have a credit card, as long as we know it's your device, it's about you and your content. It's not about our devices or our cloud servers or anything else, which is an interesting take, a very human take.
I want to be very fair because I, you know, I use other stuff and I compliment other stuff. I thought the Samsung approach, try everything, release everything, and see what consumers like, was an interesting approach. But we've often criticized companies for moving, you know, thinking in terms of the quarterly result and moving too quickly and moving this way and that way. So when a company does something that really the market's not going to like and analysts are going to complain about, and even users are going to complain about, but it does it right and methodically and slowly and carefully, I have to praise them. I think that is really remarkable in this day and age. And
it comes down to the real benefit of all the money that that Apple has isn't the ability to buy Beats. It really is the ability to control and dictate their own destiny. They don't have to listen to any, they don't have any pressure from anybody to do anything other than exactly what they want to do. And when they have a roadmap that is so clearly going to pay off big, boy, does it pay off. Now, I'm glad that there are multiple companies that are pursuing multiple points of view. I'm glad that, for instance,
it's good to have competition.
Particularly because right now that we actually have on the immediate horizon, inter-app communication, inter-app functionality, extensions, notifications that are actionable, some customization going on, or some new widgets and stuff that will happen that will help you out when you're launching apps and managing people. That's now that we have it. But remember that for years, we had no idea if Apple even had any interest in that. And meanwhile, for 2 years, that was all available to anybody who had an Android device. And it worked very, very well. So I'm just glad that there are so many different points of view being represented with different operating systems and different hardware.
We're going to take a break, come back and talk more. There's lots more to say about what we've learned after WWDC. Some interesting rumors and speculation about the Beats acquisition and more still to come. Andy Ihnatko from the Chicago Sun-Times, from iMore.com, Rene Ritchie, Alex Lindsay of Pixel Corps. Our show today brought to you by Lynda.com. What do you want to learn today? Boy, when you talk about Lynda, there's nothing you can't learn. Everything from using OS X Mavericks and soon OS X Yosemite to developing for iOS 7 and iOS 8. I was just looking to see if they had any tutorials on Swift yet. But I'm sure they're working on them right now, I got to say. This is an amazing place. Lynda.com, you've probably heard me talk about it before. Thousands of courses, 2,400 with more added weekly. They're all produced at the highest quality. These aren't homemade YouTube videos. By the best instructors, people we know and love, people we respect, many of whom have actually appeared on some of our shows.
I know Norman.
Norman's great. He's a professor at the... Okay, look, you're learning about film from a professor at USC Film School.
Exactly.
Can you get better than that? I don't think so. Awesome.
You know when I signed up for Lynda?
When?
In the second week.
Yeah, well, I've known Lynda Wyman since she was on the screensaver. She started doing great books on web design. They have classes and, you know, even business skill classes, business software, of course, but business skills like negotiation, communication, data analysis, online marketing, CAD, design, of course, Photoshop. In fact, Bert Monroy's incredible Photoshop videos are free at the beginning of each week. You can watch them. Lightroom 5, basics of image sharing, up and running with QuickBooks Online, getting things done. Steam OS for developers for first look, things like that. I mean, this is a great resource for anybody. What's nice is it's a flat fee. $25 a month gives you access to all the courses. For $37.50 a month, you can get the premium plan, which gives you exercise files so you can work along with your instructors. But right now, we're giving you 7 days of complete run of the place for free, which is pretty cool.
If you haven't done this, you just take the 7 days, go out and check it out.
How much can you learn in 7 days?
the big thing is that you don't. What you very quickly realize is you have this huge resource of professional level, you know, how to's that you can go through. And it's not just that it's 9 hours of Photoshop. It's broken all up into little bits and pieces of, oh, I need to learn this one little thing. Like I was checking my work for I did a microphone class for our students in Rwanda. And I I was checking my work and I ended up on lynda.com and there's a video on how to put mics on and how to do them. And it was a great, you know, well shot video. And you know, and it's just, you know, almost anything you can think of, especially in media, but they've definitely expanded to a lot of other things. And you just realize for $25 a month, it's just like this little thing you have in your back pocket that you can just jump in and grab a little bit of knowledge here and there as you need it. And yeah, almost everybody I know has a subscription.
Chris Breen teaches for him. I mean, everybody does. It's really a great place. So get the 7 days free. It'll give you a good idea of how much fun it is. By the way, we should say it's fun to learn at lynda.com. Not only effective, but fun. LYNDA.com/MacBreak for your 7 days free. Do give it a try. It is a great way to learn. And they have corporate memberships. We of course, have a group membership for our staff so that if they want to polish up their skills, it's a good thing for a company to do. LYNDA.com/MacBreak. Oh, I finally got enough juice. It's starting to boot. Oh, wait a minute.
Hello, planet.
Waiting for activation. This may take some time. Yeah. It may take a long time.
Put your AT&T SIM in.
A long time.
Your mini SIM, I think.
You know, it's interesting, though. It's got the right date and time. That's pretty impressive, isn't it? Low battery, I know. So here's the, this is the original iPhone. You know what? I must have wiped it because this is the way it came out of the box, right?
That's the update that gave it the App Store. And
oh, is this the
iOS 2.0?
Oh, look, it's got an app date, App Store. But, wow. So this is iOS 2.0? That's fun.
And look how long it took to open that settings tray.
And yet, you can, I mean, it doesn't look so very different, does it? I'm actually kind of impressed.
Pinstripes.
Yeah, you get the background, the linens and all that, but.
It does put iOS 7 in perspective that this was this had been an operating system that had a user interface that had been pretty static for like 6 years.
Right.
And so it was probably time to annoy a lot of people, but make some big changes.
Oh, but this feels like I'm seeing an old friend once again. Wow. Maps. There's Google Maps. Remember that? When it came with Google?
When they liked each other.
Crazy.
For Eric some Schmidt reason, it doesn't. It only seems
it doesn't have the updated Wi-Fi chip, so it only has like
B?
A and B in there, I don't think we have. Well,
know-how guest. It was just very slow. But this,
yeah, I don't think we have.
These are
many
our B
Wi-Fi
networks.
Yeah,
these are
I don't think B we networks. Have many networks that work.
Wow,
I think it's trying to find your notebook, which today is the hub of your digital experience.
Yeah, have you synced it with iTunes yet? Because that might.
I haven't. I don't. Oh, it did say, welcome to your new iPhone. It also is offering to restore from my backup of the iPhone 5. That probably is not a good idea.
No.
I assume you purchased this on eBay because this is old.
Wow, we've never seen anything quite so old. All right, I'm going to put
a revolutionary phone, Leo. You're holding revolution in your hand.
I'm kind of sad that I wiped it. So, kids, something just a little. Yeah. If you're not going to sell it on Gazelle, if you're going to keep it around, as I have, don't wipe it, because that's your little time machine.
I still have my MessagePad 2000 that still has every friend I was in regular contact with back then, every meeting that I was taking back then, notes on everything I was writing back then. And every time I pop fresh AAAs in there, it's like, oh, hello, 1997, Andy.
I have my Newton as well. I have several Newtons, and it's exactly right. All the data is, because I don't think the Newton gave you an easy way to wipe it. That's probably why.
The chat room says it has a Newton. That was their business plan.
It says it should do G.
That's what they say in the chat room. And I haven't researched it somewhere.
I don't know. I keep trying to log in and it won't let me. So I don't. It does see them now.
Oh, it does. Yeah, look at that.
Yeah, it sees the FBI surveillance fan too.
Right.
Is that you guys?
I don't know who that is.
No. I don't think so.
Must be Pixelcore.
Guest would be a good one.
Should I do guest?
Yeah.
I tried production.
Yeah, production might be weird.
Might be too hard.
Because they make sure they have the crappy old router for the guests.
I don't even know what the password is for guests.
I mean,
it's the same as you'd expect?
No, not that one.
It's not Twit Guest?
No. No. It's on the. Can you see that orange thing on the wall?
I see the sign, but I can't quite read it. Anyway, that's sufficient. Yeah. I don't want to waste a lot of time trying to get this thing working. It's fun that it's there. Welcome to your new iPhone. Doesn't match any of these pictures.
Took good care of it. No scratches. Gazelle would probably give you a pretty penny for it.
Oh, I wonder. If we do a Gazelle ad, I want to ask how much the original iPhone is worth. You know, this is something that's probably going up in value.
Yeah, it's a collector's item now.
Yeah, you wait long enough, they go up in value. Still the same crappy keyboard, though. I am so excited about the
new keyboards.
The new keyboards. I know it's dumb, but that's something that does excite me. And I'm very intrigued by what Apple's going to do with iOS 8. How about Yosemite? Anything to say about that? When will that public beta go open to everybody? Do we have any idea?
A month?
I don't know.
A little while?
Or so from now? Yeah.
How about the speculation that one of the reasons Apple bought Beats is so that they can use the Lightning cable? I'm not sure why they'd want to use the Lightning cable for headphones. To eliminate the headphone jack?
Yeah, I mean, they could get thinner with it. I don't know why they'd need Beats to do that, though. They could do that on their own.
They don't need
anything. I had to write something about this because I found it. This rumor first came up a few weeks ago and was dismissed as completely silly, so there's no need to talk about it. I finally had to write about it last week because now mainstream outlets are saying that Apple's going to remove the headphone jack, which is stupid. There are a lot of ways that they can make a lightning enabled headphone that would be really great. Like if you did want to have headphones that had biometric sensors in it, if you wanted to have headphones that had some sort of a really advanced controller inside it that could let you keep your iPhone or your whatever it is inside whatever you're carrying it around in to navigate new playlists and stuff like that. So it's not like it doesn't make sense, but it doesn't make sense for them to delete a headphone jack completely.
Well,
to get digital out? Because you can do digital out.
Higher bit rate, sure. You got Beats headphones on, you're not really concerned about it.
Do you remember the HTC phone? The HTC phone didn't have a headphone jack. You had to put that dongle splitter in, and then it went out.
Such a bad
cables.
Idea.
Yeah,
but I could see Apple. The one thing that Beats gives them is a lot of market to work with. So rather than persuading everyone, what Apple can do is go, okay, we're going to do a Beats. If you wanted to, you can get the Lightning cable for the Beats One that will not require you to use that, and you could have two cables that go into the headset, but it has extra features or whatever, and slowly and actually move it with a lot of people using it at one time. One direction or the other. So that does, I think, I know that Apple would love to get rid of another jack.
The most important thing to remember is that Apple prototypes everything. So, like, if you can think of it, they've probably done it. Doesn't mean they're going to do it, but it means that they wanted to try it themselves to see if it was a good idea or not.
You wrote a good article, Rene, on the Swift language. 4 years in the making, according to Chris Lattner. He started on it in July 2010.
Smart guy.
Wow. Interesting that Apple worked on a language for 4 years. There's some people saying, "What do we need another language for?" But so far, the responses actually seems to be pretty positive.
Yeah, I mean, the way Apple works is that they try a lot of stuff. So they had Lattner working on this. They had some people looking at Mac Ruby. They had some people looking at various scripting languages. And they sort of, over time, they figure out which direction they want to go. And then it went to the DevTools team, and they worked on it. Apple kept this a secret because almost nobody inside Apple knew about it. Very, very few people inside Apple knew about it. And then, sort of the day of the keynote, hey, you guys should go check out these resources because this is what you're going to be using in the future.
The biggest testament to me are the folks at FullStack.io who are they're planning a course in Swift. And within hours, they had Flappy Bird implemented in Swift. You could download it on GitHub.
Yeah.
Not that Flappy Bird's the hardest thing in the world to create. and open source code exists for Flappy.
But the fact is that this is a language that this person had never even heard of until a week ago, and now they've got a working thing based on it.
Right.
I've talked to a lot of developers about it, and I'm a survivor of like talking to developers about iCloud. I know when developers are cranky, there are some nitpicks, mostly about memory management I've heard about, but everyone I've talked to, even if they say that they're not going to switch all their development over to Swift, they think they're very impressed with it. They think it's a great thing. And when I say that, the usual leading question is that, if I had never developed Mac or iOS software before, and I have the choice between either learning Objective-C or learning Swift, I'd probably be learning Swift. So yes, absolutely. That'd definitely be the way to go.
Although, as somebody pointed out on Sunday on Twit, you're going to learn a language. It's going to have features that are changed, right?
Because it's not even a 1.0 yet.
It's beta, right?
So you might not want to abandon Objective-C yet.
I don't think it's the sort of thing that's going to lead people to abandon Objective-C if they've already developed those skills.
Right.
But I think that if you're coming in as a new developer, not a new developer in general, but you've never developed for Mac or iOS before, given the choice between, especially if given the range of languages that you had available to you if you're developing for other systems, if you're now you have the choice between Objective-C or Swift, I do think that most people are going to naturally say, I would much rather do Swift. It looks like it's much easier, much simpler. The given that the signature feature of it, or one of them anyway, is that bonehead mistakes that cost you time and debugging are now completely impossible. That alone, for a developer like me who writes, you know, one app a year, is a big win.
Yeah.
There was a great blog post from Brent Simmons on inessential.com where he talked about he's working on Vesper for Mac right now, and he wants to write a ton of new Swift code. He doesn't want to, you know, he wrote Newswire. He knows Objective-C probably inside and out, frontwards and backwards. But he's so excited to write it in Swift, and I think we'll get a lot of that because you have months to go before Yosemite launches anyway, so you have time to look at it. And for a lot of developers, it might be nice just to do something new.
I think it was Brent who wrote about all the bugs that wouldn't have happened had he been developing all along in Swift. So
plus, let's not overlook the fact that it is a if you write it in Swift, it will be a faster app. Right. The speed comparison was no baloney. People who are testing this are telling me that they're just seeing all these huge speed improvements that they're getting absolutely for free. They don't have to optimize anything. All they have to do is rewrite it in this language, and they get that free speed benefit. So that's not a trivial thing. That's something that might even convince people to, if they want to start converting part of their code into Swift, to actually do that. If they've been stuck with the speed bottlenecks in certain places.
And it goes back to exactly what Leo said. I mean, years ago, they did LLVM. Chris Lattner's, I think his project was LLVM, which got him hired, the lower level virtual machine. And they did Clang, and they did all these things that lets them get to the point where they have their own language written for their own compiler structure, everything that they can control and optimize so that you get those speed benefits. And that's a multi-year plan coming to fruition.
Lattner's on Twitter, and he says on Twitter, Swift is a pragmatic, not a religious language. It tries to get the defaults right, but allows you to change them if they don't suit.
And I think every developer I've talked to so far has been pretty excited about it. A lot of them didn't say they were going to leave. A lot of them said that you should still learn Objective-C, and they're not going to, you know, leave it anytime soon. But you know, completely. But they love a lot of the new features. I haven't talked to anyone who didn't like what they saw.
You know, what's really cool, and I'm very intrigued by it. It supports shebang scripts. So for those of you who've been writing Bash shell scripts, you can write your shell scripts in Swift and execute them with XC run. Swift-I, and and this is something from Lattner's Twitter. That is an interesting. What it means is you have a new scripting language for OS 10 as well,
right?
Which really intrigues me.
And it's great that Lattner is tweeting.
This is great stuff he's talking about.
Yeah.
I think the playgrounds are huge, and I do hope that people. This could very well become the teaching language of the future. Hey, let's do some... Go ahead.
He's Lattner_LLVM, I think, on Twitter.
Yes.
If you want to check him out.
Yes. Let us take some questions from the question engine, the fabulous Pixel Core question engine. There's one Luke Luxton from Toronto has gotten way voted up, so we better take that one first. Any tips about the best way to start learning Swift from scratch without any programming experience? Is it... You seem like you've done a lot on this, Rene. Is it a good language to learn as a first language, you think?
So that was one of the things that was the most popular topics at WWDC when people got a chance to look at that. And I think we might have mentioned it, but, you know, we grew up being able to type BASIC into an Apple II or being able to play with Logo. There was no way you were going to get Objective-C into you know, elementary school. But things for like App Camp for Girls, elementary schools, the Swift Playground, even REPL maybe, you can absolutely introduce someone to that. Now, you may want to start with something easier, but this at least makes it accessible to way more people at way more different levels.
I don't think it's going to be long before somebody writes how to think like a computer scientist in Swift. the thing is about Python and Ruby too. There's so many free, excellent courses, documentation. You can really, and the languages are free. And the biggest difference is they're cross-platform.
Yeah.
And I think that makes a huge difference and might be a reason why I'm not sure I'd recommend Swift. Did Lattner say anything about the idea of making this open, making this cross-platform?
Yeah. Someone asked him, and he said his goal is to get it to 1.0, and he can't even think about open source until he gets it to 1.0, which is sort of like the best Apple answer you could get at this point.
Well, I think the other thing is I don't think Apple has any interest in it, because what it gives them is a coding language that is now very tied in. They can build it with the whole language thinking about the hardware and the software that they provide. Just as Xcode was, you know, very one-sided, I think that this is just another step in that direction.
Yeah.
Although Latner is a huge open source guy, and LLVM, and I think Clang 2 are all open source projects.
Good.
Maybe somewhere down the road, but I don't think it's going to happen. I don't think anyone should hold
right now. I still use Python or Ruby, perhaps, to learn. Or, you know, I'm a big fan of Scheme and Lisp, but I'm the only man still standing who believes in that.
So Assembler. We wrote it in Assembler.
I'm an old timer. Actually, you know, learning to program with Assembler is not as bad as it might sound. You learn a lot about how the machine works. In fact, many of my first programs were written in Assembler for the 68,000 for the early Macintosh.
One of my most prized possessions as a kid was the beige small binder with the instruction set for my Merlin assembler.
Yeah. Assembly's not a bad thing. I think people sometimes think it is. And I don't know what they've done lately in Xcode with assembly, but in the early days of the Mac with MPW, you had a great macro assembler language that was beautiful, elegant, easy to program, great debugging. I like assembly, but nobody's dead yet. It's like a scheme. Nobody's going to learn that either.
It's not, right? Exactly. Because remember that back then when you had a Commodore 64 or an Apple II, that was probably the last time it was possible for an average person to have absolute mastery and control over an entire computer. Right. I think even when they went into MS-DOS, there's points at which you can't learn all about how this controller card works or how this interface works. You're going to have to just learn how to deal with it. Whereas, you know, the first time in school when I was forced to take a basic programming course, and I was because I knew assembler language, I was able to say, well, I don't like this character set. I want upper and lower case. And so I wrote an assembler in upper and lower case just to freak out my teacher.
Well, and I think that the
telling her how I did it, that was fun.
The real, you know, as an old curmudgeon, I think that the best thing for me when I learned assembly language is just really taught me structure, you know, like of how important it is. You couldn't, you know, like basic, you could do a lot of, you could run pretty loose, you know, and still get something to come out the other end. And I found that, you know, using assembly, it was, you know, and even Pascal, but using assembly was a much more, you know, you just learned a lot about programming that, you know, I think is useful. You know, I think that a lot of times, you know, these whippersnappers now, they don't have to pay attention to all these things, you know, and they're not as efficient in code.
I am jealous as hell. If I had APIs available to me and all I had to do is learn how to make this little mouse inside that's hiding inside my computer, put on the top hat and dance the way I want it to dance. I don't have to build the mouse. I don't have to teach it to dance. Oh boy, would I have first in line for that.
I was writing my own graphics apps because there wasn't anything that nothing existed. And then the Mac came out, and I was like, well, their drawing program is much better than my drawing program. And that was the end of my programming. I was like, I'm never going to catch up now.
I don't know. I'm just going to mention this tweet that I just saw from Paul Finch. A Stanley Kubrick letter to Metro Goldwyn Mayer dated August 27th. Did you see this yet, Andy?
I saw this.
1970. Dear James at MGM, it has come to my attention that you and your studio are considering producing a sequel to 2001 A Space Odyssey over my objections. My attorney informs me that you hold the option, and legally there's little I can do to stop you. However, I'd like you to know that I own the tapir bone prop from 2001, the one Moonwatcher throws into the sky. If you attempt to make a sequel, I will cram that femur up your behind. So far, it will take an as-yet-undiscovered alien superintelligence to figure out how to dislodge it. Seriously, don't mess with me. And I took out some of the bad words. Stanley. By the way, they never did make a sequel to 2001. Or did, wait a minute, they did. They made a horrible 2010.
I don't know. Roy Scheider and Helen Mirren, that's at least 40% of a really... And Bob Balaban.
I love Bob
Balaban. I think
that
those three people is 50% of any good movie.
Okay.
Even if in the far, far distant future, people were using Apple IIcs as their computers,
fine. I think they might have made that movie after Mr. Clark passed on. Is he still with us? Now, wait a minute. I don't want to say he's dead yet. I don't think he's still with us.
He's passed on, but I think 2010 was... I think that was like both Arthur C. Clarke and Cooper.
A lot later.
He, as a matter of fact, it was based on the sequel that he wrote, or partly.
Yeah. That's right. Clarke had something to do with it, not Kubrick, obviously.
Right.
Yeah. I wonder who has that tapir bone now.
He was too busy not making Eyes Wide Shut.
Oh, God. So to finally answer that question, there are some people who will be teaching Swift if you want to learn Swift. I don't think these will be courses for first-time programmers, though.
Yeah, I think the first courses are going to be the big market right now is going to be teaching folks that are doing Objective-C into Swift. So, and then the next round will be all the newbies.
And also, not now that JavaScript is now an actual system scripting language, that might be, if you want to your first programming language and to do productive and interesting things with it, that might, JavaScript might be the way to go if you don't want to do AppleScript.
Unfortunately, that letter, like the very famous Sean Connery letter, is a fake.
Oh. Darn it.
I'm so sad.
Well, we can't have nice things.
Oh, well. Oh, well, it's it is too good to be true, and that's really the fact of it. Anyway, it's fun to see.
But what a life accomplishment, that what praise for the way that a person lit his life, that a letter like that could surface, and we assume, yeah, I could definitely see Stanley Kubrick sending a letter like that.
Yeah. Here's one. Here's a question from New Orleans. Jeff Richardson, voted up by our Questions on Air team, that is you. You can go to twit.to/mbw.
I think there's like 50 or 60 questions now. So if you have we'll a get question. Through a handful of them.
Vote on them. You know, don't just don't add new them. Questions. This one, Jeff asks, what are your, this is a good one to close out this section of the show on. What are your favorite iOS 8 features that have received the least attention so far? Andy?
I would have to say the camera features. Because as good as the camera is, there's always those limitations that limit it to being just a phone camera. And not only the amount of control that you will be able to have over picture taking, but also the kind of camera apps that will now be possible. I mean, computational photography is a phrase that if you don't know by now, you will know next year. The ability to take this tiny little lens and this tiny little image sensor, and by doing lots and lots of math and taking lots of different pictures, building a synthetic image that is as good in quality as a 35-millimeter film camera, those things are possible with an A7 processor and the ability to have full control over the imaging features. So I think that photography this time next year is going to be a totally different beast on the iPhone than it ever was before.
Rene, what do you think?
I quite like a lot of the privacy features, and I feel like, Andy, they're not quite getting a lot of attention yet. For example, they're doing randomization of MAC addresses,
yeah.
So if you're scanning for the internet, they can't track you, sorry.
When you walk through a mall, even just the fact that your phone is searching for a Wi-Fi base station, if you don't connect, the fact that your ID is being broadcast, they're being collected and used, and like that's why I try to remember to turn off my phone. And I'm excited too.
Well, yeah, Andy was showing off a bag that he put his phone in a few weeks ago to make sure that they couldn't track. And that also, when you go to private browsing mode now, it just shifts you over to a whole new window. And I think they showed that for the Mac. I don't know if they've shown that for iOS or not yet. But then it switches into DuckDuckGo modes because they don't track you either. Right. And there's just throughout the entire thing, they architected it for security and privacy. And that is absolutely a differentiator that will matter to some people. And I'm glad that they're, since they don't make their money on that, they can, of course, afford to be as generous as they possibly can with that. And I, for one, appreciate it.
So iOS, and Luke actually asked about this too, is using fake or random network identifiers? Is it MAC addresses?
Yeah, MAC addresses. It randomizes the MAC address.
Right. For the phone.
Yeah.
But only like in that mode where you're not connecting to locate a base station. When you connect, then it goes to the real McCoy.
Sometimes
you're not giving it away. You're not broadcasting your identity for free when you walk through a mall anymore.
There's certainly times when you want the MAC address to be stable, like when you're doing a MAC address filtered.
Something like that.
And Apple's really is going, I think we're going to, this is just a trend that we're going to see across the hardware, the operating systems, everything is, Apple's going to constantly give you the choice of I want to be anonymous, I want to be secure, or I want to be known.
Right.
But as the user, Apple doesn't have any vested interest in doing anything other than providing that for you as a service.
Super smart.
And it's the same thing with the keyboard feature. There's the built-in keyboard is local only. All the keyboard is local stuff. If you want a fancy internet keyboard, you have to expressly tell it. Siri doesn't listen to you. You have to plug it in and expressly allow Siri to do the Hey Siri stuff, so it's not automatically listening to you all the time. Most
that's
of the
weird.
Along
you
the
have
way,
to plug it in. I keep stumbling on that.
They don't have a coprocessor. So
it's because
the Moto
battery
has a coprocessor. Yeah, yeah. So leaving the speaker on, but it's still a feature that you can enable or disable. It's something that they are very conscientious of not wanting to do too much of your stuff on the cloud.
But that works on the Nexus 5 too. You can if you're on the launcher, you can just simply say okay Google, and it will go.
Yeah, no, I love that feature.
I can't remember what it has inside, but
with my Moto X, it's gotten smarter and smarter. Now, when you can tell the Moto X, this just was updated yesterday, that your home address is, and when you're home, you can turn it on. That will read you names of people calling. It'll read you texts. It'll allow you, and so much like this Hey Siri mode, the intent is that you have the phone docked charging next to your computer, and it's now this little assistant that is talking to you. And I think that's why you would, hey Siri, yeah. when plugged in, kind of makes sense.
If I can unbottle some more excitement, there's nothing I just remembered that now there seems to be a new feature of location awareness of putting the right app on the lock screen so that
not talked about, but people have seen that in the iOS beta.
Right. So that if you are like if you are at a Starbucks and you take out your phone, the Starbucks app, if you have it installed, will be on the lock screen and no other apps.
Isn't that awesome?
Apart from the camera app. And so long as that's being done beyond like iBeacons and promotional things, so long as it's smart enough to know that, oh, actually you're at home right now, so I'll make sure that your Sonos controller is handy, because that's one of the add-on apps that I absolutely love for my Android device. Right. That it doesn't just give you a splat of 500 apps. It is, oh, I'm guessing you're right here in this situation. I'm guessing that only these three apps are going to be relevant to you.
There have been a number of launchers on the Android side that have attempted to change how they look depending on where you are. I've never been context. Happy with those.
Well, that's context. How handoff works too. It's proximity based. So if you're working on an email, it knows you're working on it and put the icon for your email either in the dock if it's on the Mac, or in the opposite the camera icon if you're on your iPhone or iPad.
It's, you know, obviously all of this has to be implemented, and we'll have to see how it's implemented. Right. But it's very exciting.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
I will suggest the drinking game that every time we say the word exciting,
you're going to be drunk fast.
You will be bombed half hour in. Any rational discussion about iOS 8 and Yosemite, if you're not really excited about what's going to be happening over the next year in Apple, you are brain dead, or you are insistent on the belief that Apple is doomed.
Randy Lominick in Mississippi asks this question. We'll wrap with this on this segment. Do you think the number of new products and openness at Apple are due to the fact that everything doesn't go through one person anymore? Tim Cook seems to be delegating more. Get the right team in place, let him run it. That does seem to be the case, right?
It definitely looks like it. I don't know if what we're seeing so far is a result of that. But I definitely think what we're seeing is a lot more of him spreading that out, which is definitely the next thing you do after you have a very strong leader, is to delegate effectively. And I think that he's the perfect person to do that.
Two observations that I can't know for sure because I don't work inside Apple. This is things from lots of conversations with lots of different people. But I don't think that it's ever been really understood exactly how much how many people contributed to almost every decision that was happening inside of Apple, where the idea of Steve, everything going through Steve and having to really sign off on absolutely signing off, but not necessarily having to steer the ship in every direction. I think that's there's a lot less of that than we think there was. But to that point, I do know, I have heard from multiple people that there's a lot more freedom to get out of your own lane inside of Apple. If there are a lot more voices in certain decisions, there's a lot more contributions again across different disciplines. And whereas before, you might under 5 or 6 or 7 years ago, you might have worried, okay, but if I say this about this, am I stepping on someone else's toes? Is this going to blow back to me? Am I going to be told that I need to be focusing on the things I'm supposed to be focusing on? There seems to be a lot more opportunities for a lot more voices to contribute to things. So on that basis, I would say yes.
Our show today brought to you, thank you, Andy. Our show today brought to you by audible.com, our favorite place to go for audio books. I'm doing something I don't like to do right now. I'm listening to two audio books simultaneously.
Schizophrenic.
I don't like to do that. I like to stick with one, get all the way through it, then go to the next one, but I have a good reason for it. I'm listening to the Beatles biography that you recommended, Andy. Tune In is the first of a trilogy of Beatles books. The total trilogy is called All These Years. And the first one, Tune In, is, 43 hours in length? So I think you can forgive me for occasionally dabbling in another book. I have to say, this you nailed it. This book by Mark Lewisohn is going to be the definitive biography of the Beatles, and is amazing. Yes. Highly like it. But then Brian Brushwood recommended The Martian. And so Lisa and I, this is different. I've never done this before. Lisa, who loves audiobooks, and I are listening to this together. She says, it's kind of like watching, Game of Thrones or House of Cards. You can't, don't you cheat on me and watch it without me. So I can only listen to The Martian when Lisa's in the same room.
Oh, that's funny.
But this is great, too. The story, it's really Robinson Crusoe on Mars, of an astronaut who gets stranded on Mars through no fault of his own or his team. It's just an accident. and needs to survive 4 years on the red planet to have any hope of rescue. And it really is a great book. I love it. So there's two good books that I'm highly recommend on Audible. But Andy has another recommendation.
Yes, it's called Billy Lynn's Long Halftime Walk. It's a novel. really, really cool premise. This was recommended to me by my friend Bill Knack, and his recommendations are always worth checking out.
In fact, you recommended Bill Knack's book not so long ago on Secretariat.
He's a legendary sports writer and especially a legend for horse racing. So he wrote something brand new about the Triple Crown for SI.com, as always worth reading. This one is, it's about this, platoon, this group of soldiers who's fighting in Iraq, and they get caught in this ferocious firefight. And there's also an embedded Fox News camera crew with them. So the footage like goes absolutely international. And the Bush administration says, oh, my God, this is our opportunity to everyone that's filled with like love for these soldiers. Let's bring them in and have them do a tour of the country to get like more support for the war. And so this is like at the end of that 2 week tour around the country. They're going to be walking out and being presented with whatever at a halftime show at a Dallas Cowboys game. And so this is like their last hurrah before they go back to Iraq. So it's just one day on Thanksgiving and these people's lives that I've only read the first four chapters of it right now. I've got it on Kindle, but it's funny, it's interesting, it's insightful, and I'm kind of eager to get to chapter five of it.
Billy Lynn's Long Halftime Walk by Ben Fountain. Okay, now you have three choices. By the way, what's awesome about this book and many of the books on audible.com is it's whisper sync for voice ready. And that means if you get the Kindle edition of it and you get a discounted version of the Kindle edition, and they just did this on iOS, this is so exciting, and you use the Kindle reader on iOS, you can take up where you left off, you can be listening to the book, then go to the Kindle app and open the book, and it'll start at that page so you can mix and match reading and listening.
I think it's a really cool feature.
What a great idea. This is whisper sync for voice ready. So Another great feature of audible.com, and they just updated the mobile apps for Kindle to support this. Before, you had to have an actual Kindle to do it.
Right.
So this is really, really great. All right. So you might say, all right, I'm sold. I'd like to find out more about listening to audiobooks at work, at school.
While cleaning.
While walking the dog. You know where I listen? Mm-hmm. In the gym. The most boring thing in the world, the treadmill. Not anymore, thanks to audible.com. And of course, if you've got a commute, you got to have audible.com. Try it today. You can pick from more than 150,000 titles, fiction, nonfiction, science fiction. Yes, all the Arthur C. Clarke novels are there. What you're going to do is if you go to audible.com/MacBreak, is you'll be signing up for the gold account. That's the book a month subscription. Subscription is the most affordable way. You can buy ad hoc. You know, just pick up a book and buy it. But it's a lot cheaper to have a subscription. The book a month also gives you the daily digest of the New York Times or the Wall Street Journal. So it's really affordable. I think you're going to like it. But the first 30 days are free. So pick a book, get it, listen to it, listen to the daily digest of the Times, the Journal. And then after 30 days, if you don't like it, you cancel. You pay nothing for the first 30 days. But if you just, and you keep the book, by the way. But if you decide to stick around, you're going to hear our recommendations on almost every show because we love talking about it. And you'll find that that's true. When you meet people who you know are Audible listeners, you got lots to talk about. It's so much fun. Audible.com/MacBreak for your free book. Try it today. Assuming we get an Apple TV refresh, asks Curtis in Utah in the U.S. of A., do we assume it will run full iOS 8? Everybody still wants the apps, but he's more interested in handoff to his TV.
Well, they didn't discuss handoff to media at all yet. That's probably going to be the subject of a fall talk, but I would be happy with one that just runs metal really, really well.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Put an M8 in there and metal, and
that seemed like the obvious target for metal.
Well, yeah.
That's the point. Handoff would be great if I come in from the library or whatever, and I've got I was watching something on Netflix. The ability to simply hand off that video to Apple TV without having to open up a player, without having to tap on AirPlay, without having to do this, that, the other. If it's just simply smart enough to say, "Oh, I see that thanks to the fact that your Apple TV is also an iBeacon, I see that you're within 4 feet of an Apple TV. So I'm going to just simply let you throw this this video right to the screen."
That seems so sensible. In fact, there are other devices that already do that. Right?
Well, and I can't do anything.
I think we saw.
So you need HomeKit to make the TV turn on first, right? So it's the conjunction of all these things.
I pray that they make this home automation work. I'm ready. I've always wanted to do total home automation, and I've dabbled in it with Hue and Sonos, but I am ready to have the whole house totally controlled from an iPhone. But you got to make this happen, and it's got to be a standard. And I will spend $1,000.
Oh, I will do
whatever.
It'll be very expensive.
You'll have to buy a hub probably, right? And devices that work with the hub.
And I think that one of the things that I started thinking about the watch more, and one of the things about the watch is when you have it on, it's going to tell you what room you're in. So the lights turn on, the door locks as you leave. So the thing is,
Bill
it doesn't
Gates
have to do a lot
this.
More than that.
If you go to the Bill Gates mansion, every person has some sort of identifier that they're walking around with. And when you go into a room, the high-res screens in the wall, and this was 15 years ago, would have paintings that you liked would come up. And it would reprogram all the screens in the room. That's the kind of thing we're talking about here.
Yeah, well, awesome. And I think that, like, you could look at behavioral stuff. Like, if I sit down at the couch, I know that you want to watch the TV, so I'm going to turn it on. I'm going to take you to your favorite shows that you're watching. I can, or show you some kind of interface. There's a lot of those kinds of things that were very, very sci-fi only a couple years ago that will probably be very, very normal not that many years in front of us,
And sound like Scarlett Johansson.
Oh, I can't wait. Just that little giggle and the breath. She's so cute. If you watch her, you could see how Joaquin Phoenix could fall in love with her. She's so adorable, right?
Right.
I can't wait. It's going to happen when I'm in the home, which is good.
Right.
I'll be in the nursing home, and I'll have a little
with your OS girlfriend.
My OS girlfriend, and I'll be happy. I'll have the Oculus Rift Visit Paris helmet on.
Yes,
it's going to be great.
With one of those, you can walk anywhere. Like you can just kind of.
I'm going to Paris with Scarlett Johansson.
Nice.
That's my goal for the retirement home.
I'll be sledding with Hobbs.
That'd be good too. I take that. John Patchkowski, I don't know how he knows. Here we are in June. He says, yes, Apple's first wearable device is slated for October. How does John know that?
Yeah, okay.
People familiar with Apple's plans.
I mean, that's the scuttlebutt. This
tells Code Red, the company hopes to schedule a special event in October to show off the device. Well, yeah, I mean, you don't even have to ask somebody. September iPhone, October iPad. I mean, that's how they do it anyway.
Right. They're definitely not doing it over the summer. I mean, there's no reason for that. They're going to, we might see some hardware computer-wise happen over the summer, but I think that they're, obviously the big push is going to be for Christmas, and so they're going to have, what we're going to see are the big upgrades, I think, in maybe late August, but that late August to mid-October, I think, is the window that we're going to see a lot of announcements. Consumer-wise.
The Nikkei says it's also, not only is it going to be in October, but the Nikkei says, which I guess, just Japanese newspaper, says it's going to produce, Apple plans to produce 3 to 5 million units a month this fall. So that's going to sell well.
Gee, it sounds low though, or at least it sounds like an expensive product. If that is true, if we're talking about hypotheticals here, but if they're trying to sell if they think they're only going to sell 3 to 5 million of these worldwide, that suggests that it wouldn't be like a $99 fitness band, which they might be able to just sell out as many as they could possibly make.
Latest iPhone 5S ad features the Wahoo Fitness Blue SC Speed Cadence Sensor, the Y-Things Health Mate, the Zepp Golf Sensor, the Misfit Shine, and the Adidas My Coach Smart Ball. That's how many wearable devices are seen in this one ad. And of course, at the very end, you see the woman running by with the iPhone on her wrist. I don't think that, on her bicep. I don't think that that's.
This is pre-health kit too.
This is an older ad, right?
Yeah.
And I've been thinking a lot about in the gym, a lot about the future integration with exercise. Where I walk up to whatever I'm doing and it's keeping track. And again, like when you're looking at how many reps you're doing, all those things are a lot easier to track with a wristwatch.
But can I just point out that Microsoft has said at E3 that they're going to build Kinect into the next Windows phone. Right now when you work out in front of your Xbox One, the Kinect senses muscle activity because it's got infrared sensing, heart rate. It actually tunes your exercise to its image of you, its infrared image of you, and says you need to work harder on that area. Well, let's do more of those knee lifts. Imagine if that were in the phone.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Like an airport scanner. Amazing.
Yeah. But the key difference is that the iPhone is the iPhone and the Windows Phone is Windows Phone.
Yeah.
When you have a technology that's the most popular phone in the world,
right.
That means that everybody's going to support it.
Well, and I can see myself working, you know, being able to like walk up to a machine, see videos on how to use that machine. I mean, if you look at the Mi Coach software, there are, you know, hundreds of animations of exactly how to produce from experts, like true experts, you know, motion capture of how to produce all these different exercises. And the next step from there is to measure how many you actually did and exactly what weight you used and all those other things. And being able to, you could get to a point where you just do the workout and it just, all that information goes in and it doesn't need to know, you know, if everything is smart. If your dumbbells have Bluetooth LE and all of the machines have all of those and everything knows that, I simply do my workout and I look down or even have something in there where it's a little thing going, pick up, you know, you're now going to do curls, pick up 35 pounds, you know, and that is, it's
figured out what those are. You're a P90X guy, so you like being beaten up.
Well, I'm right
by
now
your
just,
video.
Right now, I'm just lifting. I'm just going to the gym. So it's not. So that's why I have more time to think about it because I'm resting 90 seconds. So that's why I've been thinking about it more.
I do want, you know, and I've had little apps that do, you know, you record your reps and
but there's too much.
They have little
typing.
Timers in them, and they say, "Yeah, it should just it's know much, that." Like, why should I have to
I
tell
should
it
just
that?
Be able to walk into the gym and then do it. And
I
then,
see you've just done a 180-pound bench press. Try 190.
The next time, you know, and it's managing that. And it goes, oh, you didn't hit that. Because, I mean, that's all the decision process. And I, you know, and if you, you know, that's.
By the way, that ad I just showed, I don't know, is that the last Shy a Day ad? Apple is shifting its ads in-house. They're hiring as many as 1,000 in-house ad people to produce their own TV ads. The Apple team made the iPad Air ad, as well as the Robin Williams Dead Poets Society Write Your Own Verse ad. The internal team includes at least two people Apple stole from media, or I'm sorry, hired away two people from Media Arts Lab at TBWA unit that was designed just to serve iPhone. So they're bringing these people in-house. You know, Ford did this. Ford created Team Ford and brought in the ad agencies that were writing the stuff out of house. Brought them into Ford.
And a lot of the print stuff, I mean, the stuff that you see all the stuff you see in the store, I mean, that's all been in-house for a long time, you know, because it's just, you know, it's top secret. It has to lift with, it has to deal with all the minutiae that Apple goes through to produce anything.
One of the guys they brought in, I think we interviewed... He was at Wyden and Kennedy. I think it was part of the Old Spice campaign. And then he went from there to do Media Arts Lab, and from there he's now in-house. His name is Tyler Wisnand. He's going to lead the creative team. These are good people. Music director David Taylor. Another Wyden and Kennedy guy, Bill Davenport. So they're really 1,000 people. It's just Apple has always been the best at marketing, but now this is a full court press on marketing.
Well, it's always been that they've been very controlling about it. Now they get to have ultimate control, and the reality is it may not cost them any more than, you know, what it was doing before. It's just, you know.
So now, well, it looks like they did find their wallet for the marketing team. I mean, that was a really small team.
Yeah. Yeah, 1,000 people is a big growth. iPhone ad was produced by Media Arts Lab. That we just saw. And the Chicken Fat, we didn't play the song. You didn't want to play Chicken Fat.
It was
Fat.
In the background. It was kind of weird.
Yeah.
I think the audience wanted to hear Chicken Fat.
You can play it again if you
no,
want.
No, it's okay. Apple's...
Chicken Fat gone.
It's a strange song to play on a fitness commercial, I must admit. Mm-hmm. let's just see how the Apple stock is doing. The 7-for-1 split happened. So if you say, wow, Apple's only at $100, well, that's because you get 7 shares for every 1 share. They're at $94.19. So they're doing okay. In fact, let's look at the 1 month trend. Yeah, they seem to be doing all right.
Well, and I think that the number one reason to do this is not to make it more available for the consumer, which I don't think
that's what they always say. The price Everybody can buy a share now.
The big thing is that Apple cannot become part of the Dow Industrials, you know, the index.
With a stock over 200. Yeah.
You know, there's so nobody over 200, and most of them are under 100.
Yeah.
And I think Apple would like to be part of that.
Right. Google did the same thing.
Yep.
But a 7-for-1 split. Apple went from $646 on Friday to $93 on Monday.
Right.
And I have 7 times 0 shares. It's amazing.
Yeah, me too.
Me too.
Yeah. You know what 7 times 0 is?
Yep.
0. Oh, well. The last time I had Apple shares was before I covered Apple on a regular basis, and they probably were $30 or $40 shares. They probably were nothing. I'd be rich today. Rich. Have we heard anything about Angela Ahrendts? None of the new people. We thought maybe we'd see, I guess Dre made a phone call at WWDC. We didn't see Jimmy Iovine. We didn't see the new head of retail, Angela Ahrendts. Have we heard anything from her, or is she just nose to the grindstone getting everything going?
I think she'd be refreshing to see, you know, in a all-male presentation. Yeah. She's a really good presenter and a great speaker, so there's not any reason why she shouldn't. But I imagine she's probably going to want to be doing what she's doing and prove what she's doing before she gets up and talks about it.
Like, you'll want to talk about the Apple Store under her. When she's been doing it for a while, she'll come up and talk about what she's done with the store.
Right.
I would like to see more Jimmy Iovine.
He's unveiling all the tarps, Leo. All the tarps are off for him.
The patent troll. Oh, my God. The patent troll named Vernet X or Vernet X. They bought, of course, they don't make anything. They bought patents. Their only business is enforcing those patents. They sued Apple in East Texas. The jury in East Texas ordered Apple to pay $368 million for infringing Vernet X's patents on FaceTime and VPN on demand functions used.
Although I think the original patents had nothing to do with either of those.
No. That's usually believe me, they write the patents as broadly as they can.
Yeah.
And then they look for companies that infringe this super broad patent because it's software patents. Then in March, the judge in the matter, Leonard Davis, ordered an ongoing royalty of almost 1% of revenue from iPhones and iPads from Apple to Vernet X. 1%. Apple has been appealing this and fighting this. A decision published last week says that Apple was pursuing a poor strategy. it sounds like the judge wasn't too happy. And it looks like Vernet X could start collecting this royalty pretty soon.
I really think that, I don't know, we always complain about every time we talk about these patents, but I just feel like someone needs to prove that they actually did something with the patent. I think just thinking up the idea should not be enough.
Or worse, thinking up the idea than selling it many years later to another company that doesn't do anything but sue people.
But who determines FaceTime and VPN are worth 1% of, what are the other 99%?
That's a lot.
It's disgraceful.
By the way, Vernet X has reached licensing deals with NEC, Siemens, and Avaya. They won $200 million from Microsoft. And even after doing that, they sued him again.
Yeah.
Yep. That's why we can't have nice standardized pay FaceTime.
It really is a shame. It really is a shame. And by the way, other companies are challenging Vernet X, saying, no, we have the patent.
And again, we've spoken this before, but just a reminder, two of the best This American Lives were the whole thing about trolls.
Do listen to them.
Like, it's just a great, great pair. Because they were done like a year or two apart. And so that you get this first piece and then you get what happened later. It's really great.
Depressing.
Yeah. Let's move on. We've talked before about the first sale doctrine and the idea that when you buy stuff from Amazon and put it on your Kindle player, digital goods, or from iTunes, music and movies, that you can't hand those down as you could to your heirs, as you could a physical book or a DVD. And so members of Congress have been investigating whether copyright law should be changed so that you could resell or lend out or, in fact, will your digital goods to other people. But so far, this has not gone well.
secondhand iTunes signals.
Yeah.
But I think in a lot of ways, though, I think some of the things that the price is dropping a lot. So while we can't hand it off, it's also a much less expensive solution. I don't think it, you know, I think now it's gone up.
Who's going to want my old DVDs? Nobody. I could tell you right now. Right. On the other hand, books have a real intrinsic value in my Oxford English Dictionary, my... Right. You know, 1999 World Book Encyclopedia, my collected edition.
But I think the question is that
Boswell's
do we really think that the price is going to continue to remain what it is for digital goods down the road? You know, I think that what we've seen in the app world is probably going to happen more as that market gets a lot wider. I think that a lot of these things don't make sense when there's a handful of people. But now that, you know, when you get to a point where there's a billion people buying you know, digital books, the idea of making them less expensive at $2.99 or $3.99, I think, starts to make more sense. I think in the small, it's still relatively small market. I mean, a majority, I think, of what Amazon's selling now, but it's still, you know, not a billion people.
And the Netflix model kind of fixes this, too, because you'll just have a subscription account that you get everything anyway. And then if you pass away, your family has their own subscription account.
Yeah. There's also the bounce that you get from creators who are suffering from subscription models like that, where if you can't necessarily give your digital copies of books and movies and whatever to other people, that does, if it forces you to buy another copy of it, that's not necessarily a horrible thing for a book author.
Well, that's why family sharing might not be so popular with authors, right? The idea that you...
Well, it's not even really popular with the developers, because now already developers are being forced into a market where you can't charge $10 for an app, even no matter how much it costs and how good it is. Now they're saying that not only do I have to charge $2.99 for this, but I only get to sell one copy to a family if they're using family sharing. That's potentially two or three other sales that might be going out the window, especially with the game.
I mean, I think that that's an argument, but I think that the other side of that, though, is you have a what used to be a vibrant piracy market. I mean, and it's still vibrant to some degree, but not for this kind of stuff.
People are already doing it. I mean, I've been doing it all along with a single Apple ID. This just makes it a little more easy to manage.
Right. And it does also kind of push more developers into the in-app purchase model, because if already they know that every person in this family is going to be essentially getting a free copy of my game or my app, you may as well try to sell them Apple ID tailored content that maybe won't escape from that jail.
I think that some of that stuff is what I'm really interested in is this the inter-app stuff that we're talking about and how it could change. Also, that all kinds of in-app purchases that theoretically could happen, you know, between different applications, you know, because I think that one of the things that I've always felt with a lot of highly technical applications or even stuff like Excel or Word is if you have this huge installed base, I don't think you should just be making money selling that one thing, Word or Excel or Photoshop or whatever. You should build an entire infrastructure that lets people sell the content, but also training, where the training is really built in.
If you're Flappy Bird, you're not going to do that.
If you're going to
Flappy Bird Institute.
$1.99 or even free makes sense for Flappy Bird. It just doesn't make sense for Photoshop.
Right.
You know, so the thing is that if you build an infrastructure where I can pay, I want to learn how to use the clone tool, and I'm willing to pay $6 to see a great tutorial from, you know, or whatever, built in running my application. I mean, I think that there's a lot of opportunity there, but I think that that's where developers need
Will
to start.
Will developers
thinking.
Raise prices on apps in response to this?
You.
There are already people who are making serious money, like quit my full-time job money doing like Minecraft videos on YouTube. So it would be so difficult to be a developer to not only produce the actual app and support the app, but also produce the content for as an in-app purchase that's going to compete with a free YouTube video.
Well, the thing is the just-in-time training. I mean, and I am thinking about a professional market where, you know, I need to know how to do something in Final Cut. I mean, the first twit that we did that I did, I told Leo that I could do a multi-cam edit in Final Cut, and got back to the office.
Three
I had no idea.
Oh,
I got it done that night. I didn't sleep, but I did by 4 o'clock in the morning. It was done. But it was like, it was one of those things. Like how do I do multicam? You know, and that I would have paid $100 at that moment when I got back to watch some 10-minute thing that showed me how to do it and actually ran the application. Right. And there's a lot of people that want to figure out how to do something in Excel or whatever.
But it's a philosophical discussion that I don't know if I would. I would feel a little bit weird if I know that you're, as a developer, if Apple's motivation is let's make sure this is as easy as possible, people can really figure it out, the documentation we give away is really, really good, and we'll also sell $100 to let you do, to teach you how to do these things. It just seems more pure when you have to go to Linda for that. I want Apple to make a training that is free.
Yeah, but there's no
apps that don't.
There's no way that you're going to know how to do everything in Final Cut. There's no way that you're going to know how to do everything in Photoshop. Those are deep applications. And I'm not talking about $100. I'm saying that there are many times when I need to know how to use one feature, and I'd be happy to pay $10 for that.
But Caesar's wife must be beyond reproach. And I think that you kind of cross that. You might cross that line if, again, I'm responsible for not only giving you a good experience with this app, but I'm also going to sell you content that will teach you how to do something that you couldn't figure out on your own.
Was that a Superman Great Caesar's wife.
Well, but I think that the thing is that I think part of what makes the app better is training. I mean, I get you. You know, like that's, I mean, the thing is, for instance,
it's the same thing. We say this all the time. When people get disintermediated by the internet, you remedy it by providing service, providing value added in other ways. It's just a way, rethinking your business model. Well, but, is what you're saying.
But I'll argue also for complex apps and even relatively simple apps. But our hardware at home, again, the thing is that it increases the perceived value of that item because I know more about how to use it. Like I bought my wife this crazy expensive microwave from Panasonic and it's got all these features of how to cook things.
Was that
all
for
these
Mother's Day?
No, it was a long time ago.
I'm telling you, that's not a good idea.
No, she loved
it.
It wasn't for Mother's Day.
Bonk
I bought it,
over
it
your
and
head?
Put it in the hand. I'm not known for giving gifts on the days. I do those.
Yeah, that's
what I really
I
do
say
is
too.
I just kind of I just decide she needs something and
I'm
just buy it.
I'm gonna surprise you, honey.
And so there was just a new microwave there that of course
at
I
Mother's
bought because
Day.
It was the nicest microwave I could find for my wife. And all she does and all I do is there's this really great little dial that you turn that sets the time, and then I hit start. You know, but if I knew how to do that stuff, but you open up the manual and it is the most, you know, obtuse, you know, opaque,
yeah.
you know, thing written by someone in Japan and then translated badly into English, you know, and you're just and a piece of paper that you lose immediately.
You need
and,
Scarlett Johansson.
Yeah, exactly. If Scarlett Johansson did videos
Are
of how to use that,
to
I would be
an English muffin. Hi.
Not that
I
one.
Just,
but it's
just,
oh, yeah,
I
it is
just
that
think
one.
Of the, I just think of one of the original.
or something
Mac
like that.
Why
it's
is
not
that,
that
so
one.
Fancy? It's just
no,
got a
it's
dial.
It's not that
on.
One. That's not a Panasonic. That's an Edison.
It's a Panasonic.
Oh, is it a Panasonic? Yeah. It's like that. I mean, I don't think that that's the exact model. It might be a little bit bigger than that one, but it's like that, and it's just got a bunch of stuff. But all we know how to use is the dial, and the dial does work really well.
The dial seems like all you
really
need to
well
use.
Built.
Great
yeah.
dial.
But if it was Apple, that's all it would be, and it would be a really
right.
nice.
They shouldn't
dial.
Have those other buttons. That's just causing
little,
like,
oh,
that's
it
just
why
causing
isn't Apple making
microwaves grief to you?
You need two buttons: yeah. minute plus and start.
Yeah. You know, Apple should make a microwave. That's all I'm saying.
You know,
and it would just be a dial with a little button that you just push the dial in to set things.
Spoon with a diamond champ.
I'd buy it.
They do. It's good. And you can control with your iPhone. Like it would tell you.
It's the Beats microwave.
And because it had to be flat and made out of one block of aluminum, and it only does toast.
No, it would be a
pizza.
That's what Apple will have realized is that everybody only does one thing with their microwave is set the time.
Slice at a time.
Set the time and medium or whatever. So they build one of those, but you tie it into your iPhone, so it tells you everything about the meat and all the, whatever on an app. In fact, they make that an open API, so people could just build an app.
It's got a vibrator that you control with the iPhone. The controls are very simple.
They have those.
Yeah. Going back to the question engine, any thoughts on Photos, the Mac app, to be released next year? Why did they announce it now, so early? Will it replace iPhoto? And maybe even Aperture-esque. Movie Mac from Berlin, Deutschland.
I don't know if it's going to replace
Aperture.
We don't
know Aperture, much about it, do we?
No.
Yeah.
But I think that that's the direction that they're going.
They had to announce it because of the cloud stuff, because you know where your photo is going to go on the Mac was an obvious question.
Right.
And also, right. it shows it's one feature that shows off so much of what iOS 8 and Yosemite do.
Yeah.
Between the cloud sharing app, between the proximity apps, between it's a good demo for everything.
All right, we're going to take a break and come back with your picks of the week. Gentlemen, ready your picks. But first, I'm going to give you my pick, squarespace.com, the place to create your new website. Even if you're already hosting a website, especially if you're already hosting a website and you're not happy with the results you're getting, you ought to take a look at Squarespace. Squarespace is website hosting plus the state-of-the-art modern software that makes your website just sing. One of the things, and we're learning this now here at Twit as we work on our new website, one of the things that really is hard to do is keep up with the web. what people expect, the standards, they change, it feels like, almost monthly. But with Squarespace, you don't have to worry about that. They're incredibly talented designers and developers. Make sure that your website is gorgeous, that it works perfectly, that it lives up to all the modern web standards. For instance, mobile responsive design. Your site will look great no matter what size screen. E-commerce is built into every single template. 25 designer templates, that's where you start. They use the latest technologies, beautifully written code, but then you get to point and click, drag and drop, move without, even if you don't know anything about CSS or JavaScript, create a gorgeous website. And by the way, if you do know about CSS and JavaScript, they have a developer platform that's stunning. It's just brilliant. I want you to visit squarespace.com. Click the Get Started button. You don't need a credit card. You can actually play with your Squarespace site, import all your content in, and start using it for free for 2 weeks right now. Literally import your existing site. They have fabulous apps, too, the mobile apps. Kind of, I think they do this just to show, hey, we can develop on any platform. They've got the blog app, which lets you post and moderate comments, post articles, modify your site from your iPhone or your iPad. The metrics app, which lets you check follows, even on social media, things like that. There's a portfolio app. There's even a note-taking app. They really are so talented in what they do. The portfolio app is a simple white-labeled app that will synchronize with the galleries on your Squarespace site. So if you're a photographer, you can create the Squarespace site, create the portfolio, and then use a portfolio app to showcase your work even without an internet connection. This is a really sweet idea. I can't.
It's the only way to go.
These guys are great. Hey, go to squarespace.com. Pay them a visit. Take a look at all they can do. Try it out. And then the pricing is amazing. Starts at $8 a month. That includes a free domain name when you register for the annual plan. And, yes, e-commerce for one item or donations. Cash-only wedding, a cash wedding registry, things like that. If you want full commerce, $24 a month, and you get so much, too. Shipping calculators, inventory control, things like that. Squarespace.com. When you do decide to sign up, use our offer code MacBreak, and we'll get you 10% off. Best support, too, right from the Squarespace Hotspots offices. The support people are so good. Congratulations to my friends at Squarespace. 4 Webby Awards this year. I don't know. They're going to have to build another shelf just to hold the Webby Awards. Squarespace.com. Use the offer code MacBreak. And now it's time for our picks of the week. Let's start with the expensive guy, Mr. Alex Lindsay.
I was going to do something cheap, but now that you said expensive,
oh!
I
could go the other way. Oh, no, this is cheap.
I'll go both directions.
All right, you get two.
All right, and there's stuff that's just, I think that I've talked about in the past, so it's not, they're not brand new, but they are things to remind people that haven't heard it, that they're worth playing with. Number one is one that we actually helped develop, but it's free now, and you can get it. A lot of people ask us how we do live. We did a green screen class, and we kept on getting asked over and over again, so I realized that some people haven't heard of it. It's called Pixel Conduit. So,
Is that DV Garage, or is that?
It was DV Garage.
Yeah.
But we worked with Lacquer Effects to do it, Poly, and it's called Pixel Conduit. Pixel Conduit. It's free. And for about, I think it's $20, you can actually get a web interface. So you can actually go in, do a green screen, and pass it off to Hangout. So it's a great little app that does lots and lots of, you know, Swiss Army knife for visual effects, but just video processing. We use it for the scopes. We use it for a lot of other things. We never really figured out the business model that made it totally work, and so we just probably decided to make it available to everyone. And there's just tons. I mean, you cannot believe the kind of tools that are built into this thing, stuff that I don't even know how to use. Because he was doing lots of live stuff. And
well,
it's just
what I want, stuff you don't know how to use.
There's stuff that there's scopes, and there's green screen, and there's all kinds of other things that I use on a day-to-day basis, but there's all kinds of other image blending and you know, crazy math and the ability to drop stuff in. And so all of that stuff is stuff that you can download. So just download it and play with it. It does stereo green screen compositing, just in case you're wondering. We needed that for something. But we use it every day. And I just, you know, and when people were asking a lot during one of my classes, I thought I'd bring it back up again. So that's the free thing. And the other thing is just, you know, there's a new version out and we love it even more. And I know you guys use it here. But I just, the two things that you want to think about when you're thinking about live streaming is Wirecast, if you're doing
love
software.
It. We use it all the time.
Wirecast is the best thing to get started with. It's gonna it does a lot of things that are great. When you go to an industrial scale, you know, Elementals are we have a lot of them now. I think we have 16 of these.
How much are those Elementals, Alex?
I think that the ones that we have are somewhere between 12,000 and 25,000. It depends on what you're getting. But
they're great.
But
they
here's
work.
The deal is that it's just like we had an issue yesterday with a stream, and the ability to jump in, manage something quickly, and get out, you know, and have it go is just amazing. So, but both of them are great applications, and obviously Wirecast is a little bit more affordable and more flexible. You can do editing with it. We figured out how to get, you know, four cameras into a laptop and edit them all and add graphics and video and everything else. And so as a Swiss Army knife, it's great. But a lot of people ask me that question, so I thought I'd bring it up. That's all.
Good one. Mm-hmm. Good one. And we use Wirecast for, like, some special effects. Things that TriCaster can do, I'm sure, but it's just easier to use Wirecast.
Well, you can do it on any laptop. You know, that's the big thing. And there's a free version for you to stream to YouTube, so you can download it for free and use it that does lots of great basics.
For YouTube Live.
Yeah, for YouTube Live. Remember,
could you do Hangouts with it?
People do use it for Hangouts. We use a lot of hardware for that, but people will use it to add effects and then pass it into a Hangout. It's got its own little web tool that will let Hangouts and a couple other things, not Skype. The new Skype is pretty smart about not letting you put anything professional into it because they want to sell you something else. Wirecast is, you know, we use it a lot on the road. It's the thing that we use as our backup for our Elementals. It's the thing we use when someone, you know, has a lower budget, more corporate or educational, you know, type of thing. And it's just a great, great application.
Andy, thank you. Andy Ihnatko, your pick of the week.
It's a really great utility called Wi-Fi Explorer that you're probably familiar with. It's the most soul-sucking diagnostic you have to do is figure out why your Wi-Fi, why if you're using Wi-Fi, why does something drop out? Why is something screwing up? Why is an app suddenly disconnecting and reconnecting? And Wi-Fi Explorer is a really easy $2.99 utility that will just simply show you graphs and show you what your Wi-Fi network is doing at any given moment. And it will also, so if, for instance, just last week, iChat or messages for some reason would keep randomly disconnecting then reconnecting, and I thought, okay, is it a signal problem? And it would have been difficult to figure that out ordinarily, but all I have to do is leave this thing running. As soon as I get an audio signal that iChat has lost the connection, I can just check that graph and see that, oh, okay, nope, the Wi-Fi connection was stable, it must be something else. But you can also do things like take a look at every single Wi-Fi source that is visible to your computer. You can see what the signal to noise ratio on your signal is. You can see if there are other things, other devices that are trying to hog the Wi-Fi bandwidth. And it's a really quick way to have just get your eyeballs on what's happening in the Wi-Fi spectrum around your house. You also sometimes you have no idea how many Wi-Fi devices you actually have inside your house or next door to you until you run this app. You see, oh, that's a lot of devices. Yeah. Oh, right, my neighbor bought a new printer and it's trying to it's using the same channel as my main base station is. That could be a problem. It's a really egalitarian tool because if you're a professional, you might be using this tool to, again, once you hit a client's office, to see exactly what's going on and easily spot a problem in what might take other people hours and hours to do. If you are not an expert, it will just give you a quick thumbs up, thumbs down. Are you losing signal? Do you have a good strong signal? Are there other devices out in range that are trying to hog the same channels? It's a very, very quick way to solve very simple problems. $2.99.
Wi-Fi Explorer. Yeah, it's a must-have. And it's in the App Store.
Yes.
Mr. Rene Ritchie, what's your pick of the week?
Mine is super quick. It's the RSS reader on Red. It's a very simple, very elegant RSS reader. And the iPad version just came out yesterday.
I bought it. Love the new Mac version. Love it. 2.0.
And so if you use it on the iPhone, you want to use it on your iPad, it's just on Red. If you are still into RSS, and you should be, then it's a great way to do it.
Yep. And you're talking about Unread. Okay, so
yes.
I just got Reader for the App Store.
Yes.
2.0 just came out. Do you like Reader on the desktop?
I do.
Yeah, Reader 2 is I guess maybe I'll make that my pick. I was going to show you a whole bunch of ways to watch the World Cup online, but since you did unread for the iPad, let's keep RSS alive. Even though apparently Apple's decided to do that too.
I know.
Which kind of shocked me.
Makes you wonder what they have planned.
This is $10, but boy, is it great. It's just like bringing back Google Reader. You can sign into your Feedly or other feeds. It's what I use now to go through all the news. It's really great. And 2.0 just came out for $10, unfortunately.
That's a good thing, Leo. Supporting developers.
It's well worth it. They're really great. I was going to give you a little tip because, you know, ESPN, you can watch the World Cup. It's starting Wednesday, tomorrow, right? Or is it tomorrow or next Wednesday? Starting this Wednesday, tomorrow. U.S. doesn't play till next week, but...
this is the first time I've ever been in the country when the World Cup... I'm always, like, somewhere watching it, actually, where people are in
where they care.
Where they care, and it's so much... I mean, it's just this cultural thing that, as Americans, we often miss out on, but it's a lot of fun.
There's a lot to... even though I'm not a huge soccer fan, 3 years out of the four...
I don't understand offsides.
Come year four... I understand. I'll explain to you. Come year four, the World Cup, it just makes me so excited... I was so sad when the World Cup ended last time in South Africa.
Right.
Spain won. U.S. did all right. I think they're going to do even better this time. But whatever country you're in, if you are in the U.S., ESPN is a sucky way to watch it. They haven't watched ESPN app, but your cable company has to support it. DirecTV does not.
What?
You have to. It's that same thing with like HBO Go where you log in with your right. cable account. Yes, I could prove I have cable.
So if you're
a cord cutter, now you have to understand Spanish. But soccer's better in Spanish anyway.
They're not saying anything.
Univision's Deport or Desport, or I don't know how you pronounce it, Deportes app, will without logging into your cable company or anything, let you watch the World Cup in Spanish. Now, you can set the app itself to English, which is great. But the game will be obviously in Spanish. However, I think as long as you can see what's going on, it doesn't really matter, right?
Yes.
Yes. And I'll tell you something. Goal! In any language is the same.
It's the same. Just wait until they're all clapping.
Goal!
Yeah, exactly.
So,
football.
Football. Univision Deportes is, you must get it. You must get it. And we will all be watching. And it's free. And it is on the iPad. And as far as I can tell, you don't have to sign up with your cable company or anything. They're just going to have the games.
That's great.
Isn't that great? In Spanish. I think most other countries are probably allowing this, but it's just in the U.S.
They're so excited. Their commentary is amazing.
Yeah, I almost prefer, even though I don't understand the Spanish very well, I kind of understand it. I'd prefer to watch how, because they get so excited.
Pay someone Spanish or Scottish. That's the rule.
Scottish would be good. Now, yeah. I should check and see if the Scottish National Network.
I think I might have the same trouble actually understanding what was going on as I would with Spanish.
Did you see John Oliver's takedown of FIFA on Sunday?
FIFA is so corrupt. They're so corrupt, I think. I didn't see what he said.
He went all out. Like, that was a whole new level of what the...
Yeah, because I guess the next... in 8 years, the World Cup is going to be in a country that actually doesn't
Qatar, even... That 4,000 people will die between now and then just to build the stadiums.
Doesn't really play soccer.
Right.
Yeah, but also, again, people dying who are building these stadiums. Yeah. And, you know, Brazil, where the FIFA has the power to basically create its own laws.
Yeah.
Saying that we have, for the last one, that they had their own police force, essentially, and somebody who caused a disruption was arrested on Wednesday, tried on Thursday, and started a 20-year jail sentence on Friday.
Jeez. Hey, we believe
that's
in
like, dear.
Accelerated access to justice.
And that was
here.
Maradona.
Yes.
I mean,
Maradona.
Certainly faster than the goal scoring in any of their games.
Yeah. Boom! Do they in Montreal? I would imagine that soccer is a fairly important sport in Montreal.
We have the Montreal Impact. I mean, we have very few sports teams now, so we guard them jealously.
Right.
We don't want Americans to steal them and make them into champions.
I'm just going to sign into this Univision.
We lost the Nordiques. We lost the Expos. We lost the Royals.
That's right. The Expos and the Royals. I remember them.
Yeah.
Oh, well.
Still... my favorite, I've always be a fan of the Bruins, but if I have to pick up the greatest name in professional hockey, it's the Quebec Nordiques.
The Nordiques.
I just love that name. Nordiques.
Vive le Nordiques.
Even better than the Maple Leafs, I think.
Leafs.
And they became with the Avalanche, right?
Oh, that's so
started winning.
That's the worst. Insult to injury. All right, my friends, we are done. We are done. We have cooked it. It is cooked.
Well cooked.
Well cooked. We do the show every Tuesday, 11 a.m. Pacific, 2 p.m. Eastern time. 1800 UTC on twit.tv. Please join us. Watch live. We appreciate it if you do. And if not, on-demand audio and video shall be made available in all the usual places, including, of course, the Twit apps, which are really great. We don't do them, but I do recommend them on iPad, iPhone, even Windows Phone and Android. We'll be back next week. Thanks so much to Rene Ritchie, imore.com, for being here. Alex, yeah. Lindsay, will you come back to town tomorrow, next week, I should say?
Next week, I do plan to be
return
here.
For us.
Yes.
Mr. Andy Ihnatko from the Chicago Sun-Times. So good to have you all.
So good to be here.
Show is so much fun to do. Thank you for being here. Thank you all for watching. But unfortunately, it is time to say back to work because break time is over.